Thank you, Jennifer Goldfinch. Thank you to the Foundry team for your support. You've been with us from day one when we just had a little PowerPoint presentation presenting humbly what real-time conference could be. It became something completely different than what we were anticipating at the beginning, but I hope you enjoy the conference. Back to you, Jan.
Thanks, Jean-Michel. It's now my pleasure to introduce Dan Ring, Head of Research at the Foundry. Hi, Dan, how are you?
Hi, Ian. Hi, Jean-Michel. Hi, Real-Time Conference. Great to be back. Yeah, thanks a million for having us. I'm joined today by Kevin Tod Haug, VFX designer for Commandante. And I'm going to try and share my screen now, if that's all right. So yeah, thanks a million again for having us. We're really excited to share an interesting story in the reality of real-time, in particular for a very kind of interesting and unique project. And to tell the story of this project, I'm going to rewind slightly to the inaugural real-time conference all the way back into the beginning of 2020, where we presented our concept of the timeline of truth. And essentially, in a very quick nutshell, the idea was about creating a single source of truth for a production and allowing kind of metadata and any data that's generated on set to be able to kind of pass through each stage of production efficiently. And the idea being that, like, it, you know, it helps and makes everything more cost effective and reduce the amount of effort to build things and improves quality of everything. And in a very kind of nutshell, the specific problem that we really wanted to focus in on was the what's called the digital divide, or the analog abyss. And it's when a director says cut, and particularly in virtual production, that a lot of the data that's generated on set or even before then is thrown away. And then it means then post-production often has to regenerate things, and you know, you're having to duplicate work. Now, this message really resonated with a number of people, but in particular, there was a man named Peter Canning, who is part of the high-res LED consultancy group in Dublin here. And he reached out and said, hey, can I talk to you about this really interesting project? Now, I should give a disclaimer before I hand this over to Kevin. Those of you in the first two rows are in the splash zone. You may get wet. Kevin.
Hi, Kevin Haug, visual effects designer. I'm going to show you some quick reference here. The movie is Commandante. It is a true story about a submarine commander, Italian submarine commander, at the very beginning of World War II. He's kind of a national hero, unknown outside of Italy. We have great black and white footage for reference, but we also have some great sort of fascist propaganda stills. So when I first got the script and I read it, and I started looking at the reference, I realized that, well, first off, backs of submarines are convex, so you can't hide the waterline. And the actual sea battles tended to happen in really, wet circumstances. And so I finally got to this particular piece of art and realized that, okay, it's an Italian movie. It will not be an animated scene. It's going to have to be real actors standing on a deck getting hit by real water. So much for blue screen, green screen. LED panels, great, we're going to do that. Except that background is a gigantic water sim, also some fire and spray and explosions and a bunch of other things that are all very heavy, very not real-time sorts of things to be putting onto the LED wall. So here we have these sort of disparate issues that have to be worked out. And then I meet with the director, who very quickly says that he had really wanted to do this practically out in the middle of the Atlantic, wasn't allowed to do it, and is very worried that visual effects is going to mean him giving control of his set over to a bunch of geeks. And then ultimately, when it gets down to the end of the line, he's going to be left all alone without his creative heads around him, making decisions that he can't undo. These being his only experiences with visual effects. So I had to promise, it will be a set that's under your control that allows you to work the way you work. And then, you know, in a panic, I called Peter Canning. And Peter Canning introduced me ultimately to Dan, but I'm going to let Peter talk to you about it.
My name is Peter Canning, and I'm working with Hi-Res in Dublin. This particular workflow with Commander is a really unique workflow. So working with the team from Foundry and with Kevin and all of the production team, we found it really, really exciting, because this workflow will allow for low-res LED screens to be used in particular scenarios. For example, in this scenario where we're having to deal with a water tank, high-res LED screen, 2mm, 1mm even screens won't work in this scenario because they're indoor screens. This screen is going to get wet. But also from a creative point of view, it's capturing the light from the screen. So utilizing that light, as we all know, is something that's one of the big benefits of virtual production. As well as the really high resolution graphics and the workflows for capturing those graphics, the actual light and the reflections are something that sometimes get overlooked. This particular workflow, because we can implement the low-res screens, is allowing us to actually use LED screens in a workflow that has never been done before. That's the one reason that we find this really, really exciting.
So basically, to sum up, we have a we can't use any traditional green and blue screen. We can't use animation that's heavy like Sims on a wall in real time. So we have to come up with a solution, develop a new way of doing this. And so this is where Mr. Ring came into it. We put together some resources and we went to Dublin to Hi-Rez's previous stage. But in order to have anything to play there, in best practices, I took the director and sat him down in his home in Napoli and got Habib Zarkabor to use his, he's possibly the best virtual camera operator in the world. And we did previs for a couple of weeks spread out all across the planet. So this is what we ultimately sent to the to editorial and cut together so that we could see what the director had in mind literally for these scenes.
Dalle torrette fiere ogni sguardo attento sta, facili ed invisibili, partono i sommergibili, fuori e motori da salitori contro l'immensità. Andar per il vasto mar, ridendo in faccia monna morte dal destino, colpir e seppellir ogni nemico che si incontra sul cammino.
I'm really glad the we fixed the audio for that because you really needed that rousing music for this hour of the morning.
Right. It's actually the Royal Italian Navy's Submariner theme song from very period. So then we picked one shot out of the previs, shot number 9, that had like pretty much every problem we could pack into it. One of the first one you see is tracking and focusing through the screen into the background and back again. And then someday we're going to have to deal with the whip pan to a big giant splash. So with this, we had it converted. All the animation was done by EDI, Effetti Digitali Italiani, and they converted the stuff that we got from Habib into Unreal so that we could use it at high res. And here I am at high res. That's Paul Conlon from the local camera service 24/7. So we brought in an ARRI, and yes, if you look in the background, you can see that it's an anamorphic lens. That's also one of the parameters of this, is that we can't be, we can't tell the DP what he gets to use, and he's telling us it's an anamorphic show. So we're having to work this way as well. So I'm going to let Dan take you through how we put this all together at Hi-Rez.
Thanks, Gavin. So we did a couple of tests at Hi-Rez, and this is their previs suite here in Dublin. And this is a relatively small section of wall here, but this is absolutely perfect for the thing that we were trying to get. So in this shot, obviously for shot 9, you can see that there's a kind of the camera wasn't wide enough, or the camera angle was so wide that we obviously couldn't fit the entirety of the wall in for this shot, and we're off wall. So it means that we're gonna have to do a huge amount of background replacement. And the goal for this was to see, could we get all of that footage, bring it into Nuke and start post-production on it straight away. And you can see here from this example here, This is what we ended up with towards the end of the week. And this started looking promising that this near real-time workflow might actually work. More recently, we did a really nice test in 86 Studios out in West London. And the great folks at 86, when we talked to them about the project, they immediately understood what we were trying to do and the requirements. And they built a couple of sections of wall and ceiling for us, particularly using coarser pixel pitch LED, the Rode CB3, which is 3.8 mil pixel pitch. And this is closer to the kind of outdoor LED pixel pitch that we'll be eventually using for the shoot. The other things that we wanted to test in this were actually using the kind of a greater amount of space. So we know that the director wants to do a kind of like a variety of kind of camera moves, and he has quite long, likes doing like long camera moves. So we needed this extra space. But we also got in the fabulous folks from Moses came along and they integrated their star tracker here, as well as providing a huge amount of kind of on-set assistance and expertise to the shoot. So by the end of this, we were pretty happy with where we got to. So now the NRT workflow, the near real-time workflow, what does an example take actually look like? And how do you use this? What does this look like? So when the camera's rolling, all of the metadata from camera tracks to lens information to camera data is all being streamed and recorded in Unreal. We're also capturing the image stream into Nuke directly is in a kind of a take recorder. Once the take is finished, the images are delivered straight into Nuke immediately. And now we're in post. We can then use Nuke's new Unreal Reader tool to render from Unreal that take into Nuke. And then you can start beginning compositing. And the first thing that we want to do is show the director immediately what they just shot. And this is what it kind of looks like. So as I mentioned, we start by using the Unreal Reader tool, which is just released in Nuke, to render a higher resolution and higher quality version of the Unreal take. So this is a higher resolution that would have gone to the LED wall. And once we have that, we want to overlay that in a very simple sort of difference overlay. Like, so here's the first time where we start merging the virtual and physical in a very simple overlay. But this, even though this image looks a bit funny, this is incredibly important to the directors and producers because they can make decisions on it. They can act on this. They can know whether the actor was looking the right way, whether the timings of the things were correct, and also whether they can move on. So can they move to the next setup? It also allows, I mean, because we're in near real time now, we can ask Unreal to re-render stuff. We can also noodle things. We can move the plane around if we wanted to and get a kind of a, or adjust the animation of it slightly. So that's that. Now, I'm going to jump slightly into kind of what we're calling these sort of aha moments. And there was three key unique aha and eureka moments during these tests. The first one is this one. This is where, if you look in the top, this is what we captured in camera. And this is with the render of Unreal being displayed on the LED wall. On the bottom is our near real-time workflow where we've replaced the background with a render from Unreal. And we've aligned the time on them. Now what you can see in the top is that you can see a huge amount of lag actually. You can see that the real and virtual are slipping. And we're doing a kind of a tracking move here, which is where that sort of lag is most noticeable. Now, most virtual production systems introduce lag, it's often unavoidable. But what we realized when we started doing this is that the tracking system here, in this case, we were using the Waro Easy Track system. It was so accurate and it was so spot on, and the position information that you got from the camera was so well correlated to what the actual camera was doing. When we did the re-render, everything just locked. So you can see on the bottom, the virtual and real are perfectly time aligned. And this is an incredible eureka moment where you could see we got a better version of what we just shot and we got a more accurate version of what we just shot. And going back to our timeline of truth idea, we're making the best use of all of that metadata that we have available to us. So now that we're starting to marry the real and virtual, there's two key components that we really need to do in order to make this illusion work. The first is to get a key to separate the background from the foreground. So imagine we've shot this. we need to separate this actor here from the background in order that we can, to replace the background. And we're going to do this inside of Nuke using an AI tool called Copycat. And we've developed a process as part of this workflow where you can shoot against a green or blue screen. So you turn the LED wall green or blue. You ask the actor to do a bunch of rehearsal takes of movements that are representative of what they're going to do. We then bring that footage into Nuke. We use Nuke's keying tools to generate kind of, you know, a high quality key and map. And once we have it, we get something like this. We then take this and then add this to, like, add this image to some synthetic backgrounds, but backgrounds that are like representative of either the wall or the studio environment. This will become important later. We then use that as a data set for Copycat. So you can see here the AI training here in the background. And this training takes a number of minutes. So in as soon as sort of, you know, roughly sort of 20 minutes, you could have a model that's usable. But if you leave it longer or leave it running overnight, you can get a higher quality model. And see here, you can, this is an example of quality. And you can see here that the hair is captured pretty nicely. Also, you can review this live in Nuke. So here we have the live camera feed coming through Nuke, and we're displaying kind of the result of that model live. And this is important so that you can review how good your model is performing for the given takes, for the given scenes, for the given actors, and to see if you need to train any extra. So that's the first component. The second component then is really critical. And this is where you need to model the physical lens. In order to make the real and virtual images sit correctly, obviously a renderer doesn't necessarily know too much about like how a lens distorts or is shaded or vignettes. So you need to model that. And when we got brought into this production, we were introduced to David Stump here, who was Mr. Lens Metadata. And I'm gonna let him explain the value of this.
I'm David Stump ASC. I'm a director of photography and a visual effects supervisor. Metadata is very important in modern workflows for cinema. The metadata that is available from modern lenses gives you an advantage in time, it saves you money, it saves you a lot of trouble in reverse engineering the optics of any given scene for visual effects work. Cooke have instituted a program of empirically measuring every lens that they manufacture on a special machine that pixel accurately quantifies every ray in the lens. When you have good, accurate lens metadata, when you have lens maps, when you have JSON files that will give you the distortion parameters of a lens and the shading parameters of a lens, you have got a head start on finishing your visual effects. A big head start.
So yeah, as mentioned, when we were brought into the project, Dave had looped us in, and he'd also introduced us to the amazing people at Cooke Optics. And as Kevin said, the show is likely going to be shot on anamorphics, in particular this lovely anamorphic 40mm lens here. And David took us through kind of Cooke's process and the kind of the work that Cooke has been doing in the background on modeling and mapping these lenses and encoding these distortion and shading coefficients all inside the lens. And we wanted to explore how to use that. So as I said, the goal here, as somebody who has spent a lot of their career mapping and calibrating lenses, indulge me for a moment while I take you through kind of the calibration process. So normally how you'd calibrate a lens is you'd put a checkerboard up on a LED wall, or you'd have a checkerboard kind of poster, and you'd shoot it with the lens, and then in software, you'd then calibrate it. So you basically use some software to try and straighten out these lines or find the model that straightens out these lines. And so you'd go from something like this to something that looks like this. And you can see here that the lines should be kind of a good bit straighter. And if we zoom in here a bit, you can see, yes, these lines are fairly straight. However, if you look at the proportion and the sort of aspect ratio of the checkers at the left of the image, it's different from the checkers, the aspect ratios of the checkers at the right of the image. Now, in a lot of cases, this is fine, but we knew that this wasn't gonna work. And in Nuke itself, so this is using Nuke's lens distortion tool, I wasn't able to get a better calibration than this. Then we took the coefficients that were in that JSON file that David Stump had described, And we added them and sort of integrated those into Nuke's lens mapping system. But when we did that and we undistorted with Cooke's data, we got a result that looked like this. And you can see here that the squares here, the checkers, the proportions are perfectly uniform across the image. This was another one of these light bulb moments of like, hold on, this is a huge major advancement. And I'm hoping anybody who's ever had to calibrate grids is looking at this and going, wow, this was incredible for us. So just to kind of show you the kind of like the differences, I'm going to do a quick sort of like A-B here. And you should be able to see that the squeeze and stretch here. Now, you might be saying, Dan, it's 3:30 in the morning. Why are you showing me lens grids, you maniac? The reason why I'm showing you these and why it's so important, not just for this project, but for the industry in general, is that calibration of lenses, like with grids by hand, is incredibly time consuming. You need time on set. You need to kind of, you know, halt production. You need to kind of grab the lenses. It does interrupt production. So any time saved there is huge. Now, calibrating a lens can take anywhere from kind of minutes to hours to possibly even a week if you've got multiple lenses to do. Versus Cooke's lens mapping system, which when it was all working, we got this in the matter of seconds. And Cooke have done an extremely good job of sort of creating a database of all of their lens profiles, of all the ones that they've put into their machine. And so this to us represents several orders of magnitude kind of advancement in the field of lens metadata. So I've talked about like how we marry the real and the virtual. Now let me show you some examples. So the first is just a simple sort of static test. So this is where we've replaced the background with a render of Unreal, static camera. And the thing to kind of that's interesting here is the matte, the kind of AI matte that we're getting here. Now you can see here that the hair is pretty well captured. We're also capturing the kind of the tripod gun here that we're using. Now, normally, like if you were using kind of other kind of off-the-shelf kind of AI systems, you might not be able to capture that gun as well. But what's interesting here is you're getting the full amount of the light from the wall, from the ceiling, and you're kind of seeing the quality of the AI. But this is a boring shot. This is a static shot. We wanted to really push things. And this brings us to our next kind of aha moment. And this is where we get into, this is where once we had everything set up, we asked the producer, Pierre Paolo Verga, you know, what kind of shots do you want to shoot? And he answered us by picking the camera up, putting it on the shoulder and shooting this. And so this is like kind of, you know, he wanted to go between the kind of the submarine, the background, the actor's feet. He really wanted to kind of explore this. And this is kind of what the director likes to do as well. But you wanted kind of complete freedom, didn't want to be bound by, you know, the constraints of the wall or the width or size of the wall. And here's Pier Paolo here. And you can see here, he's really excited. He's like really enjoying kind of this experience of playing with this. And this is why, this is our eureka moment. At the top, you can see what was captured in the camera. And you can see a lot of it, there's no wall in there at all. And the AI system here is able to kind of correctly kind of spot the, you know, not just wall or person, but just person. And then here we're able to kind of replace it. I'm not sure if it's coming through, but there's moire artifacts on the top. And also then, yeah, we're adding, you know, we're able to capture in kind of, you know, all of the nice goodness of the wall, but you know, he's still free to kind of move around and like look at feet and do all these things. And the final thing then, again, the thing that really sealed the deal is, we're doing post-production now. So when we look down here and we notice that there weren't any shadows in the feed originally, we were able to comp these in very, very quickly in a matter of minutes. Similarly, there was an issue with tracking where we lost track for a couple of frames. We were able to really quickly snap the track back in here and using very simple 2D comp tricks. But that was able to, you're able to do that in a matter of minutes, and you could, you know, return that and you've basically iterated on that shot, you know, there and then. That's what you can do in a matter of minutes. So imagine what you can do then if you've got more time. And I'll hand it back over to Kevin.
So I'm going to jump in here to say that the timeline of truth steps in here where we have this data, everything that's been done, all the little tweaks, all the things that made that temp comp work can now be packaged up sent off to, in this case, Bottleship in Sofia, Bulgaria, who are working on a sim for the background. And we said, I don't care what state it's in at the moment, comp this together and let us see it. They sent it to the cloud and they sent it back to us. And now we have a version that has big, complicated sim in it that would not have been possible to do in real time. And in a decisionable time frame. If assuming all goes well with the weight of the shot and some other issues that might get in the way, this is capable of getting back in the hands of the director before he moves on to another setup, or at least before he moves on to another stage or any other thing that can't really be done without it costing a lot of money and holding things up. So this is sort of the AD's dream, that they're able to actually see more or less a final version of the shot that the director can with confidence walk away with. And finally, there will be in the NRT workflow, this is a very flexible, interactive way of working, and it allows the director to pretty much choose how to use it, which is the ultimate promise from the beginning with this director, is that he could feel that it was his set and his way of working. Also, it was very flexible in terms of being able to add good things that come along. The metadata from the Cooke lenses was something that was completely unknown to us when we walked into it, and it made all the difference in the world of being able to put those anamorphic comps together in a reasonable period of time, essentially real time. And then finally, the kind of the biggest aha moment for me is post is now not relegated to after you've shot something. Post can start the second you begin production. It now informs everything about the way you shot something, and it doesn't have to stop there. It doesn't, an in-camera comp is not your ultimate goal. It is the middle point of the process, just like it always has been. And you can go on in post as long as you need to make it perfect, which means you can now finish some shots on the day, some shots in a couple of days, some shots by the end of the director's cut, and some, and we've all worked on those, you know, weeks later. And yet it can be a traditional post length that we have these days, 22 some odd weeks, because it began at the beginning of production. And basically at the end of the director's cut, the movie's finished, at least visual effects wise.
So yeah, so I suppose if you've been following this along, you've probably seen that this we've really skimmed the top of the surface with this. Like we haven't gone into any detail of this, and there's a huge amount of depth to go into here. I did want to call out that a lot of this workflow is you can do right now using the Unreal Reader and CopyCap tools that are available in NUGEX 13.1 now. But we do want to kind of do more deeper dives into this workflow with longer presentations, but also we want to kind of let everybody hear about the work that's happened from our project partners involved in this too. We also want to share material and guides and code and scripts as well. This is a very open workflow. This isn't closed source or anything. We want to make sure that anybody who wants to experiment with this is able to. So we're really hoping to be and looking forward to being able to share exact materials that you can get your hands on very soon. If anybody's interested, please do register your interest at virtual.events@foundry.com, and we'll keep you posted. And finally, I just want to say that a huge special thanks to everybody here. This really has been a kind of a massively collaborative effort from a number of different partners. And while Kevin and I have had the privilege of kind of going through this with you and sharing it with you, this hasn't just been our work. This has been kind of from a number of different partners. So huge thank you to everyone here. Huge thank you to RealTime Conference. Huge thank you to Ian. Huge thank you to everybody who's watching at home or wherever you are. And huge thank you for having us again. And hope to see you all again soon.
Brilliant. Dan and Kevin, that was fantastic. I can't wait to learn more about this production. And Dan, can I just give you a shout out for being awake at 3:30 a.m. in, I'm guessing, Dublin or wherever you are. Yeah. So sorry about that. That's terrible. But thank you so much for doing that. It was really great. Thanks again, Dan and Kevin.
Thank you all. And I want to recommend that you stay and watch what Habib will show you. The other scene we did, which is really about interactive light. So anyway. Talk to you later.
Awesome. Thanks, guys. They're coming up soon. I'm just going to jump back to Jean-Michel.
Thank you, Jan. Thank you, Dan. It's always a pleasure to welcome you at RTC, who are a usual suspect. And it was, I think, the first time, Kevin, that we had the pleasure and the privilege to welcome you to RTC. So I hope there will be many, many more. Thank you for joining us.